Welcome everybody. Last week we have looked into the concept of energy and the energy use of some major sectors. By now, it will be clear for you all that our energy need in the world is quite significant. So the big question is, do we have enough renewable energy sources available on planet Earth to sustain our enormous energy need? This week, we will look at the most important renewable energy sources. We will make rough estimations on what these energy sources potentially can deliver in reference to our energy needs. We will do this using rough back-of-the-envelope calculations. This week, we'll give you some first insights in what are the opportunities and the limitations of the various energy sources. Be aware that we only make rough estimations this week. Later on during this course, we will look in more detail to the technological and system aspects of the various renewable energy sources. In this first video lecture, we will take a look at hydropower. There are many large hydropower plants around the world, but most of them look like this. Water that contains potential energy is collected in a reservoir behind a dam and flows to the intake. The water is forced through the pipe or penstock by gravity. The turbine in the dam is pushed in motion and the potential energy is converted to mechanical energy. The turbine is connected to a huge electric generator to convert the mechanical energy into electrical energy. The generator is connected via transformers to the electricity grid to deliver electricity in the grid. Losses in the systems are mainly caused by friction at the edges of the pipe. The turbine and electrical losses also further reduce the efficiency of the dam. When estimating the potential energy of hydropower, the most important factors are the available water flow, either via melting snow or rain, and the height difference of the water representing the potential energy to be converted. As example, we take a close look at the Itaipu Dam on the border of Brazil and Paraguay to get a feeling of how to estimate the potential of hydro energy. The Itaipu Dam is the second largest hydropower plant on the planet. It has a total installed generation capacity of 14 gigawatts and has reached a record energy generation of 98.6 terawatt hours per year, or 0.27 terawatt hours per day. If we assume the generated energy is solely used by the 200 million inhabitants of Brazil, we arrive at a total electricity generation of 1.35 kilowatt hours for every person every day. Let's relate that back to the energy unit of one person as we have discussed last week. One personal unit of energy was equal to 2.9 kilowatt hours per day, so 1.35 kilowatt hours per person per day would equal to 0.45 man units of energy production per day. Another way of comparing the yield of any renewable energy source is to look at the annual energy yield per rate power, or in other words, how much kilowatt hours of energy is generated per year per watt of installed capacity. In this case, we have to divide the 98.6 terawatt hours by the 14 gigawatt of installed capacity. For the Itaipu Dam, we arrive at a little more than 7 kilowatt hours per watt per year. A value expressed in kilowatt hours per watt per year will also be used for other renewable technologies we introduced this week for comparisons. Another parameter used in the industry to compare the production of different power plants is the capacity factor. It's an easy tool to estimate energy production over a period of time. The Itaipu Dam has a capacity factor of 0.80%, which is the annual production divided by the installed capacity and the hours in a year, which is 8,760 hours. So you could say on average the dam produces 80% of the time electricity on maximum capacity. For fossil fuel plants like gas and coal plants, the capacity factor can be very close to one, meaning it will run almost continuously on installed capacity. This is something electricity grid operators are very keen of to ensure stability of the grid. Other renewable energy sources like solar and wind can have much lower capacity factors. We will look in those factors later this week. For now, we will make an estimate of the potential of hydroelectricity. Let's work through an example. Let's say a certain region has about 500 millimeters of rain per year and there is no meltwater from mountain snow or glaciers. 500 millimeters of rain per year is equal to 0.5 cubic meters of water per square meter. By multiplying that with the density of water, which is around 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter, we get that per square meter of land there is 500 kilograms of water per year. To calculate the potential energy of this amount of water, we will use this equation, where E pot is the potential energy in joule, m is the mass of the water in kilograms, g is the gravitational constant, which is equal to 9.8 meters per square second, and h is the height difference between the source and the outflow of the dam, which we assume here to be 100 meters. For these numbers, we get 490 kilojoules of potential energy per square meter per year, which is equal to about 0.14 kilowatt hours. So now we know the energy density in terms of kilowatt hours per square meters per year. We can express this in power per area by dividing by the total seconds in a year to get at 0.015 watts per square meters or 15 milliwatts per square meters. However, this calculation assumes that all potential energy is converted into electricity. In reality, this is not the case and dependent on the landscape surrounding of the dam. A hydroelectricity dam is usually built next to a natural lake or water reservoir that collects the water fallen on a large area through a network of rivers. The total area from which the reservoir collects the water is referred to as the catchment area, enclosed by the red line in this picture. If we know the size of this area, we can estimate the total energy potential of a certain region or dam. Now we are going back to the Itaipu Dam and we'll make a rough estimation to verify its typical power and yield. The catchment area stretches an incredible 1.35 million square kilometers. In this area, the average annual rainfall is about 1,650 millimeters per year. About 1,000 millimeters per year of this water is evaporated before it's passing the dam. The remainder equals a mass of 0.65 cubic meters of water. If you take the height of the dam, which is 196 meters, using the potential energy formula, we arrive at 0.35 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. The overall conversion efficiency of potential energy to electrical energy of this dam is estimated to be about 20%, including the collection losses as well as the conversion efficiency of the turbines in the dam itself. With this conversion efficiency of 20%, we arrived at an achieved energy density of 0.07 kilowatt hours per square meters per year, or 70 watt hours per square meters per year. If we now take a look at the actual data of the dam and divide the annual energy production which of the dam by the catchment area, we find that they are achieving approximately 0.073 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. This is almost the same energy density as we found a moment ago when calculating the potential and achievable energy density. However, we can also take the reservoir surface area of 1,350 square kilometers as a measure for the required land. This gives a good indication of the amount of land that is sacrificed for the hydropower plant and is often used when comparing the impact of hydropower plants. When we do this, we get a higher energy density of 73 kilowatt hours per square meters per year. It is also interesting to take a look at the surface power density or specific power for both defined areas. We can find this by dividing the energy density by all the hours in a year. For the entire catchment area, we get a power density of 0.008 watts per square meters or 8 milliwatts per square meters. Whereas for the reservoir surface area, we find a surface power density of 8.3 watts per square meters. As you can see, with some fairly simple rough calculations, a general estimate can be made of the potential energy that can be gained from this source. However, the energy potential is not the only factor that should be considered. Also, the immediate and long-term effects on the surrounding and the climate should be taken into account. Hydroelectricity mostly requires a dam to be built in order to create a reservoir. This reservoir has a huge impact on the local flora, fauna, and landscape. In case of really large hydroelectricity projects, the local climate could even change due to the change in the water cycle. One of the biggest benefits of hydropower is the consistency of the power source because of its high capacity factor. Although it's not always free from some seasonal intermittency, also because of the scale of the projects and the lifetime of 30 to over 100 years, the carbon footprint per kilowatt hour of the generated energy as well as the cost per kilowatt hour are low. Typically, the carbon footprint of hydroelectricity is 24 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour on average, according to research of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change from 2014. This is much lower than coal-fired power plants, which have an average carbon footprint of 820 grams CO2 per kilowatt hour. However, the carbon footprint of hydropower does greatly depend on each individual project. As you can see, there are a few major factors that have to be already be in place before hydropower can be considered. The most important factor is the availability of water and a most natural height difference. Also, the environmental impact of a hydropower plant should be taken into account. Because of the necessity of a natural feature that allows for the easy implementation of hydropower and the impact on the surroundings of a dam, the global potential of a new hydropower is relatively limited. In 2015, the estimated global installed capacity was 1,211 gigawatts, producing approximately 3,975 terawatt hours of electricity. This represents approximately 16.6% of the global electricity demand and about 70% of all renewable electricity. We can also express the production of hydroelectricity in our own units. If we divide it by the global population of 7.4 billion people and days in a year, we get 1.47 kilowatt hour per person per day of electricity. This is a slightly more than half a human unit, which we introduced last week. Estimations for the global potential of energy for hydro go up to 25% of the global energy use. With these tools we discussed now, you can try to make your own assessment of hydroelectricity. In the next video, we will look into physical potentials of wind energy. See you in the next block.